these large cities, they're really kind of magnets for human capital and for investment destinations. Like cities like, you know, London have got $900 billion worth of GDP, and Tokyo's 1.5 billion, New York's about 2 trillion. So these cities are sitting well ahead of a number of other metros around the world, and they still continue to be those like sources of capital as well as the destinations for capital. And that's one of the things that we actually track with our survey from year to year.
Yeah, unpack the data that's compiled and presented in this survey. What does it track? What do the rankings essentially mean at the end of the day?
Yeah, so the prime rankings is really like a framing for our investment decisions for a strategy we call Global Prime, which actually exclusively invests in global gateway cities and the best quality assets in these cities. So we're looking at economic indicators, we're looking at infrastructure and institutions such as hospitals and universities, capital flows, livability indices, as well as property-specific market factors as well too. So we're looking at supply and vacancy and construction rates in each of these markets.
Has, of course, the flood of cheap money that we've seen as a result of the pandemic and, of course, the action from central banks really contributed to big changes that we've seen across the property landscape? We're going to talk a little bit more about Australia in a moment when it comes to residential property, but when it comes to a number of other factors, driving investment, driving capital, how critical has, of course, the record low borrowing costs and money market rates been that we've seen?
I think they've been a real catalyst for M&A activity, which we've seen quite a number of deals around the world. So most recently, we've seen some data centers getting taken private or getting taken out by larger companies. We've seen office stocks in Europe being privatized or merged into other entities as well. So that cheap cost of funding, and I think importantly, the amount of availability of capital has actually propelled valuations of real estate more broadly and has actually allowed the listed sector to kind of keep up to speed with that. Notwithstanding that, there's some sectors which still are trading quite significant discounts to intrinsic value, and we're seeing that in the office and the retail sector. So I think that there's plenty of more corporate activity, I think, on the horizon for the listed REIT market.